Very nice to be here with you all from the traditional territory of the Luangan speaking peoples in Victoria. My paper is called Why We Love Stompin' Tom's Moronic Musical Paean to the Game. And I will start with a musical rendition. Oh, the good old hockey game. It's the best game you can name. And the best game you can name is the good old hockey game. The hockey song appeared originally on Stompin' Tom Connor's 1973 album, Stompin' Tom and the Hockey Song. It has been a staple of Canadian popular culture ever since. As Sandra Martin puts it in her 2013 Globe and Mail obituary of Connor's, the hockey song connected with the quintessential Canadian audience, hockey fans, to the point where the song became an unofficial anthem for the Ottawa Senators and later the Toronto Maple Leafs, and so on. Not everyone loves the song, of course. John McFarlane, in his editor's notes for the special issue of The Walrus devoted to hockey, refers to it as Stompin' Tom Connor's moronic musical paean to the game. Rather than dismiss the song as simply moronic, however, I think as scholars, it's worthwhile to examine the elements in the song that might account for its continuing popularity. Not surprisingly, these elements reproduce and reinforce what I would call a conservative version of the game, consistent with what a number of scholars, beginning with Whitson and Gruneau in their classic 1993 study, Hockey Night in Canada, have called the hockey myth. So, what are the elements of the song? To begin, the title. At first glance, there's something humble about Connor's title. This is just the hockey song, it implies. Not some fancy composition worthy of a fancy title. Yet the definite article also carries a suggestion of the one and only. This is the hockey song, not just a hockey song. Despite having a certain aw-shucks quality to it then, the title implies that this is the definitive song about hockey, the song that distills what is most valuable and worth conserving about the game. And this is reflected in the content that follows. The body of the hockey song, as you can see, is divided into three verses, each of which enacts one period of a hockey game. The first verse conveys the excitement of the game's beginning, leading up to a goal scored by Bobby. The second describes how the home team falls behind but fights back to tie the score 1-1. The third focuses on the third period and is also described in the spoken introduction on the recording as the last game of the playoffs. In the final verse, the home team scores, wins the Stanley Cup. And between the three verses, there is the chorus that I sang to begin with. The story told by the hockey song is one found over and over again in popular representations of sport. The three verses replicate what's typically found on highlight reels. What is the protagonist of Kara Headley's 20 Miles, a wonderful novel about women's hockey, calls the Coles notes of a hockey game. The climax in the third verse is typical of popular films and literature in North America about sport, in which a hero makes a deciding play, the ninth inning home run, the last second touchdown, and of course the overtime goal. Michael Oriard argues that this plot pattern was established by the vast juvenile sports literature in the United States of the early 20th century. Every juvenile sports novel, he says, concludes with a big game or its equivalent in which the hero achieves his triumph. Generally, this big game is further reduced to a heroic moment. The hero's triumph makes him the premier citizen of his community, praised, admired, and immortalized. This narrative pattern, the narrative pattern in which a final sport triumph crowns a hero, reflects popular ideas about sport itself. For this reason, there's often a mutually reinforcing relationship between popular sport representations and the heroes created by sport. This is Oriard again. Sport exists, in a sense, to create heroes. And sports, literature, fiction, whatever, can be viewed from one perspective as a genre that defines who the representative hero is. The hockey song deviates from the pattern described by Oriard by not having an individual hero who is celebrated for scoring the winning goal. This is in keeping with the song's emphasis on hockey as a ritual of communal identity. In Canada, as you all know, Hockey is often celebrated as a way of building community in the face of the specific challenges of the Canadian geography and climate. And this is famously done in Ken Dryden and Roy McGregor's 1989 book, aptly titled Home Game, Hockey and Life in Canada. And hockey, this is their quote, hockey helps us express what it feels to be Canadian, point of contact. They describe the winter, the land, frozen winter. All of these, he says, makes Canada feel more Canadian. This passage reproduces key elements of the hockey myth. Compare it to the definition of the myth Whitson and Gruneau give in their second book about hockey, the edited collection Artificial Ice from 2006. This is there. In Canada, hockey has been widely understood as connoting a kind of happy naturalism, a direct expression of our ability to survive, indeed to thrive, in an inhospitable land of ice and snow, long winters and vast open spaces. This naturalism has been sustained in innumerable images of apple cheek boys in frozen ponds and in a host of literary references to hockey's roots in the Canadian climate and landscape. Although the word Canada does not occur in the hockey song, the Canadian identity of the community described is strongly implied. The opening words of the song, "Hello out there," is a direct echo of Foster Hewitt's iconic opening from the original radio broadcasts of Hockey Night in Canada. "Hello, Canada and hockey fans in the United States and Newfoundland," right? It's also, that's also parodied, by the way, in King Lear, Paul Corrington's great hockey novel. The fact that Tom Connors was a well-known Canadian folk singer implies a Canadian context, as does the cover of the album from which the song comes. So here's the cover of the album. This shows a hockey game between players with uniforms recognizable despite the whited out logos as those of the Toronto Maple Leafs and the Montreal Canadiens. And those of us who are old enough will recognize the mask on that goalie and will know that that's Ken Dryden. One of the fascinating things about the hockey song is the way that it evokes a small town atmosphere, even as the game described is clearly professional, because the prize in the game is the Stanley Cup. A number of aspects of the song contribute to this effect. The familiarity of the references to Bobby in the first stanza and the home team in the third play a part, as does the country music to which the song is set. There's also an aura of innocence about the game. This is a professional game with no mention of money, and in which the only violence is when players bump. There's also the song's use of the word "all" in the good all hockey game, that contraction, O-L-E. That word, of course, evokes nostalgia, tradition, and folksy authenticity all at once. And these values are conventionally associated with small towns. It wouldn't be too much of a stretch, I think, to say that the hockey game, the hockey song, champions the good old hockey game in much the same way as the Grand Ole Opry promotes a small town and rural version of the United States. Another song that performs a similar imaginative sleight of hand, describing a professional game but evoking a small town atmosphere, is of course, Take Me Out to the Ball Game. This is a 1908 song from Jack Norwich and Albert von Tilzer, and as you will know, is the unofficial anthem of North American baseball. The hockey song, in fact, as you probably already know, noticed, echoes Take Me Out to the Ball Game in some important ways. Though they're rarely sung, the verses of Take Me Out to the Ball Game tells a story of a baseball mad young woman named Katie Casey, who insists that her beau take her to a game instead of the movies, and a great girlfriend in 1908, right? No, I don't want to go to the movies. Take me to a ball game instead, right? And at the ball game, she gets to cheer for her hometown crew in the first stanza. And at the end, she cheers on the boys she knew, right? At the end of the second verse, the score is tied and Katie makes the crowd sing the chorus of the song to cheer the home team to victory. Storyline very reminiscent of the hockey song. There are two other important parallels. Well, here's a bunch of parallels. You can see them by the colored marks. Obviously, the line, "Oh, take me where the hockey players," is an echo of the chorus of Take Me Out to the Ball Game, right? Take me out to the ball game. Oh, take me where the hockey players. And also the good old hockey game in Connors is an echo of the old ball game in Take Me Out to the Ball Game. Connors certainly knew, had to have known Take Me Out to the Ball Game, and he probably deliberately echoed it. More important than the echoes themselves, however, is how the echoes reinforce the conservative version of the game in the song. The actions distill the highlights. There's cheering for the home team as a ritual of communal identity. And the identity itself is implied to be in small town terms. This is, of course, again, brings us back to the innocent aura of the game in both songs, perhaps best captured by how these songs portray professional players as boys. The hockey song then hints at a spiritual affinity between the game played between the game portrayed in the song and the game played by Applecheek boys on frozen ponds, just as Take Me Out to the Ball Game implies a spiritual connection between professional baseball and the game played by similarly Applecheek boys on small town sandlots. It is important to note that the aura of innocence about hockey in the hockey song is an effect not only of what is in the song, but of what isn't. Not only does the song imply this spiritual affinity, but it's silent on the harsher realities of the game. This is characteristic of conservative or mythic representations of hockey, as well as other sports. Such representations tend to portray their games as if they exist outside of history. History is often uncomfortable. And those of you I know are very familiar with the history of hockey. You know, there are lots of uncomfortable moments in the history of hockey. A more critical response to the hockey song would stress these historical conditions that are excluded. But that's paper for another day. Today, I just want to highlight these elements that might help explain the song's popularity. One last point about the seductive power of the song. Interesting that what is most valuable about the game in the song is conveyed ultimately in religious terms. The ritual quality of the song, its formal regularity and implied communal performance is very much a sing-along song, has a liturgical quality to it. It's like a hymn, right? The religious quality is especially strong in the chorus, which is not only ritual-like in form, but insists on an act of faith to be believed. Note that the logic of the chorus is circular. Why is hockey the best game you can name? Because the best game you can name is the good old hockey game. It just goes around and around. Combined with the aggressive tribalism implied by this circularity, our game is the best because it is, there's something in it of the either you get it or you don't of religious faith. This is an aspect Michael Novak stresses in his classic study of sport when he draws this parallel between sports and religion. Why do I love sports, he asks. How can I explain it to myself, let alone to others, especially to those who are skeptical unbelievers? You either see or you don't see what the excitement is. The same thing, I think, could be said of the hockey song. Thank you.
Thank you, Jamie, very much. For those of you who have considered buying one of Jamie's CDs, I can guarantee you the sound is much better and the voice much more enjoyable than his little rendition of the hockey song. He's an artist, beautiful singer as well. Okay, so can we move the hosting duties then to Jason? Yeah. And Jason, would you give yourself a tiny intro before you start? And then again, I'll watch the time. And if you're near 15 minutes, I'll say something.
So Jason,
sure.
You should be getting the host baton.
All right. I'll try to share my screen here. See if that works. And
Yep, you're good.
Okay, so I'll just set up here. I won't be able to see you in presenter mode. So thanks for joining us, everybody. My name is Jason Holt. I'm a professor in the School of Kinesiology at Acadia University. One of my areas of specialty is the philosophy of sport. It's not an old area relative to other spheres of philosophy. It's only about 50 years old, but there are some important thinkers in the field, and none more prominent than Bernard Suits. And hockey occupies an interesting place in his philosophy of sport and games. And so we're going to look at the connection today. So for Suits, the philosophy of sport generally, and hockey as illustrating a number of the aspects of his philosophy of sport, is seen through the broader lens of games in terms of theoretical components that we're going to unpack here, but that are canonically expressed in perhaps the most important book in the philosophy of sport called The Grasshopper, Games, Life, and Utopia. And we'll look at that theory of games in outline here. Suits's compressed definition of what it means to play a game, and sports again are going to be types of game, is the voluntary attempt to overcome unnecessary obstacles. So in something like hockey, you want to put the puck in the net, of course, but there are obstacles in the way, like the goaltender, for instance, like having to wait for play and so on, like following the rules. These rules of play are the unnecessary obstacles you willingly accept as artificial constraints because they make the game possible and you want to play the game. More specifically, the elements of gameplay for Suits are as follows. One, the prelusory goal, the object of the game, the thing you're trying to achieve, and it's prelusory. It's conceptually prior to the rules of the game, insofar as you can describe what you're trying to do without appealing to the rules. So what are you trying to do? Put the puck in the net, for instance. Games also have not just objects, but rules. And for Suits, these are constitutive rules. The game is constituted by its rules. It's differentiated from other games by its rules. In fact, the game will be defined, he often says, by its rules. And the losery attitude is what it takes for someone to participate as a player in a game. You accept these rules as binding because they make the activity possible. Suits is also a formalist in this sense, because games are defined by their rules. When you break the rules, either deliberately, as in cheating, or accidentally, you're actually failing to play the game. And this is going to become prominent in my discussion later on. Sports are specific types of games, those that involve physical skill, whose outcome is determined by athleticism, and there are other factors, but we don't have to talk about those here. Suits is an institutionalist about sports as well. And the utopia in The Grasshopper is one in which ideal human existence, in Suits's vision, consists primarily of game playing. What we do or would do in an ideal existence in a utopia is spend most of our time playing games. And that would be a good thing. So this is the general basic theory, and let's look at how it applies to hockey and how Suits uses hockey to illustrate some of these points. Suits is quite explicit that in an ideal human world, hockey would be one of those games that we play. So hockey, probably not in the realistic sense dramatizations weed out, would be played in utopia, and it would be played beautifully. He also uses hockey as an example to illustrate a prelusory goal, that is putting the puck in the net, putting a particular rubber disc in a certain location that can be described without appeal to the rules. He also uses hockey as an illustration of how games put artificial constraints on activity. So some people think that games and playing games is a matter of reducing what you're doing to some basic instrumental function. But as Suits observes, playing hockey is a ludicrously inefficient way of putting rubber discs in nets. And that's part of what we like about it. Oh, looks like I'm admitting Cheryl. That doesn't seem right. I shouldn't have that authority. Suits likewise uses hockey to illustrate how what matters to playing a game isn't whether you're an amateur or a professional, whatever your further motivation for engaging in a particular activity, what really counts for playing the game is having the losery attitude. So the professional hockey player and the amateur share a losery attitude in accepting the rules of hockey as they play. Again, Suits's formalism comes up. He thinks games are defined by their rules, and he has as an illustration of constitutive rules in games, the offside rule. He actually doesn't say whether he means hockey or football or rugby or soccer, but he probably means hockey inclusively here. And that's a bone of contention for critics of Suits. Where, say, you go offside, you typically have a whistle, face off outside the zone, and that restores game integrity. But if you didn't have that, if rules were being broken all over the place and not redressed by official rulings, then you wouldn't really be playing the game. Just as a critical point here, Klaus Meyer, a critic of Suits, says that offside rules in hockey and elsewhere really aren't constitutive. They don't define what hockey is. They're regulative. They govern how hockey is or should be played, at least in certain contexts. So if you go offside for Meyer, you're still playing the game, just not legally. Whereas for Suits, if you go offside, you're not playing hockey at all. But that's not exactly the debate I want to focus on. What I want to focus on is cheating and game integrity. So I'm going to use as an example here, Brett Hull. I'm not knocking Brett Hull, but some of us may remember the infamous I need my legal stick incident in documentary. Now, I know he was playing with the Stars for the time, but this is an image of one of the rookie cards of Brett Hull that I have, so I wanted to show that off. So don't knock me for historical inaccuracy there. So what would Suits and what would the formalists say about this? And what would critics say? Well, you can probably see where this is going. For the Suitsian formalist, a quote, goal scored with an illegal stick is no goal at all. The anti-formalist, and there are different ways of resisting this conclusion, is to say, look, a goal, even with an illegal stick, is still going to count as a goal so long as it's not caught. If we have the infraction caught, the penalty imposed, then obviously the goal doesn't count. But if the cheater gets away with it for the anti-formalist, then the goal counts as legitimate. So Suits, as a formalist here, seems to be running afoul of the intuitions of most philosophers of sport who think, unfortunately, sometimes if you get away with certain forms of cheating, you are still playing the game. Moving on. Although the anti-formalist is probably right, at least considering the consensus view in the philosophy of sport, most philosophers of sport are what are called interpretivists. They think it's the logic of the game that dictates whether rule violations count as maintaining or removing game integrity. I think the formalist nonetheless has an important insight here. The anti-formalist story ends there. Certain rule violations don't undermine game integrity. The formalist, on the other hand, their view suggests that there might actually be something else going on. And that, I think, is the heart of the insight. So the formalist, though mistaken, is actually getting at something really interesting that the anti-formalist doesn't. Oh, I'm admitting someone else. We're popular today. So what else is going on? Well, it's something like this from a formalist perspective. And I think this insight applies whether or not cheating in a particular instance maintains or undermines game integrity. The other thing that's going on is that the cheater seems to be playing a different game, even in Suitsian terms. They're playing a different game. Specifically, what I want to call a meta game. So you're using the object game, hockey, as a means of achieving some further end. We can call it the getting away with it game. In this particular case, we're talking about an illegal advantage in hockey. And if you get away with it, you have not only, say, scored a goal in hockey, you've achieved victory in the meta game, what we might call meta hockey, if you successfully get away with using an illegal stick. You're playing hockey potentially, but also this meta hockey game. The meta game would be dependent on and different from and use the object game. And there are interesting conceptual relations there. And I am monitoring the time, and it won't take me long to finish up. Now, one could object here and say that the idea that you're not supposed to get caught cheating is actually a rule of skill rather than a constitutive rule. And constitutive rules are defined by inefficiency, whereas you want to cheat in the most efficient way and actually increase efficiency rather than the inefficiency that defines games. And we don't have to go into detail there, but there is a way of responding to this. Rules of skill might actually be identical to constitutive rules in metagames. You break it and you lose. If you get caught and the goal is called back, for instance, if you've used an illegal stick, then you've lost the metagame. So rule of skill or otherwise, it's still a constitutive rule that defines that game. Now, I know some of this was kind of abstract philosophical stuff, but it does show the important role of hockey in perhaps the most important book in the philosophy of sport written in the last 50 years, as old as this area of the discipline is. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jason. We're all gonna wanna know about the skate in the crease in 1999. So as soon as I can get my paper finished, we'll get right to talking about that. So could you make me a co-host or pass the hosting to me? I don't have a fancy presentation, but I do have a couple of pages of my paper that I want to show because it's where the theory is. So for those of you listening, it'll be a little easier to follow. I'm Brian Kennedy. I have a PhD in British literature and teach in the field. I'm professor of English at Pasadena City College. I'm Canadian. I grew up in Montreal and Peterborough, and made my way to the States for grad school and ended up in California, where I've had the good fortune of getting involved with the National Hockey League in the form of being a writer, a credentialed NHL media member. So to this point, I've attended and written about 651 NHL games as a credentialed media member, including an All-Star game, the draft, two Stanley Cup finals, and lots of other magical events. And I largely credit that to my participation in the hockey conference in 2004. So Andrew Holman, if you're still sitting in this room, I've told you this a million times, you changed my life with your conference and I love you for that. And so I do two things. I write about literature and theory and I write about hockey and I try to blend the two. So this paper is my sort of musings on one of the matters related to that. Now, let me see before I get going, if I can find my document here. Okay. Oops, I just made Zoom disappear. Why did I do that? Okay, so I will share my screen at the appropriate time. So what is sports journalism in the age of simulation, or how Twitter changed your favorite sport? You're hearing me okay, everybody? Good. Here's a snippet of a conversation between Hockey Night in Canada and Sportsnet's Elliot Friedman and Jeff Merrick on the 31 Thoughts podcast from an episode aired on May 14th, just last month, 2021. They're speaking of how clubs go about decision-making with respect to coaching changes, but the larger context here is the savagery of hockey fans on Twitter, a recurring theme on the podcast and on Sportsnet Radio's Hockey Central show, which comes on every day. Here's Friedman. I do think that in general, most people are more risk averse now. Social media has changed how criticism reaches us and how efficient criticism can be. It used to be when we were kids, it was a letter to the editor, maybe an email to your boss, but nobody else saw it. Now it's out there, it's constant, and everyone can see it. And I think that's creating, in general, a more risk-averse society. I see people more and more afraid to make decisions in general, in all walks of life, and more afraid to put themselves out there than ever. Co-host Jeff Merrick replies, quote, we're in an era when tech solves a lot of things and solves things quickly. So right now it seems as if there is a collision between I don't want to take a lot of risks and the expectation to think things can change quickly because we're so conditioned by technology that that's what happens in our day-to-day world. It's a weird spot that we're existing in right now, one of hesitation and one of sprint going on at exactly the same time. This just leads to anxiety and wringing your hands about everything. And maybe we're seeing this played out in all different areas of our life, most namely sports. Keep this in mind from the above. Taking risk and making decisions can be read as analogs for writing authoritatively when it comes to sports coverage, something that is almost lost in contemporary sports media. I want to figure out why and whether it is possible to reverse the flow. As we know, technology has made it possible for anyone to participate in the discussions surrounding sports or politics or other things for that matter, because it has radically refigured access and thus exploded the authority which in the past reserved a voice for certain people. That sounds good as it goes, but the freedom this represents often devolves into a license to be vindictive, judgmental, or simply to substitute opinion for interpretation. Using media in the contemporary moment is not like being media was in the past, and the gulf is wide. When anyone with minimal tech can create a site, jump on Twitter, or blog about the game, what does it mean to contribute? And what happened to the notional connection of presence to authority? I would like to ponder how media is author/ized in the present moment, discussing what new media has done for or to the discourse surrounding sports. I'll frame these questions through Jean Baudrillard's notion as presented in Simulacra and Simulation, using his trajectory of stages of gradual removal of the sign order from reality as a starting point to delve into the current age of electronic media and questions of access and authenticity. So let me just quickly show you. Oh, here we go. Sharing is good. Okay, so just to start, here is a set of terms that are not Baudrillard's terms, but which I abstracted from his discussion. And I'll show you more specifically how this applies to hockey writing as we go. So Baudrillard identified four phases of shift in media production, which can be named reflecting, obscuring, unmooring, and equivocating. They exist on a sliding scale of what used to be called authenticity, where reflecting is writing a faithful copy, and on the other end of the scale, equivocating is creating a simulacrum which has no relationship to reality at all. Encoding this drift as an inevitability, Baudrillard anticipated the revolution which happened when Apple introduced the iPhone in 2007 and sparked a sea change in media culture. Now, everyone could speak. But what happens when everything becomes narrative? When story is not just the construction of a writer's impressions based on fact observed, but an equivocation that lacks any external reference? Further, with so many stories competing and everyone having the freedom to frame the story as he or she wishes to, what becomes of conversation? Twitter, which gained its first real popularity in 2007, very quickly changed the nature of publication, which became a no filter, no layers endeavor. Anything, anybody can say anything they want to, and they do. Add to that the sheer multiplicity of outlets, and you have a situation where the stream of sports information has become a rapids. Before social media, the authority that came from a layer of editorial control made professional writing what it was. This distinction has mostly ceased to matter in an era, in an age when even reporters from traditional outlets must supplement their journalistic output with tweets. Jimson Lee calls it communicative abundance and notes that, quote, everyone has direct access to public space and the ability to influence what happens within it. The idea of a user-generated content started out as an enhancement to coverage, pulling watchers into the orbit of the media outlet providing content and engaging them, and maximizing their focus on the media outlet itself, as described by Kirsten Fransden. But focus quickly shifted to privilege fan voices. Forbes described the usefulness of Twitter in 2014. Quote, sports fans are 67% more likely to use Twitter as their second screen viewing experience compared to non-sports fans. The platform's versatility and its concise messaging make it the industry's ideal real-time content provider and now a built-in part of the sports world, end quote. But there's a cost. Fransden says, quote, for fans, watching sports transmissions often involves shouting and yelling from the safe position on the couch in the living room. Viewers may carry their attitudes and communicative behaviors from that viewing situation to their internet posts. The discursive space constructed by the proliferation of media is labeled by David Terrace as the, quote, media ghetto. And he says it this way, this is the space where individual and collective fan discourse is constantly reshaped. It is the sphere of fan activity that provides a growing portion of the content that supplements the game action. The media ghetto accommodates the casual fan who may only have a passing interest in anything more than the game scores, as well as the many fans who engage hockey on various levels of intensity. Taken together, and this next part I just reproduced here for you to see, these phenomena have resulted in what Baudrillard described well ahead of the fact in Simulacra and Simulation, which was published in French in 1981. As I said, he identified four phases of shift in media production, which can be named reflecting, obscuring, unmooring, and equivocating. I could describe the two poles of this shift by saying that reflecting is writing a faithful copy. Let's say in the context of hockey, a game report based on direct observation, combined with asking players for their interpretations. And on the other end of the scale, equivocating is creating a simulacrum which has no relationship to reality at all. In the present context, let's say tweets unsupported by direct observation or expertise. Moving from one pole to the other could be read as the drift from authenticity to simulation. Encoding this drift as an inevitability, Baudrillard anticipated the revolution which happened with the introduction of the smartphone. My point is not to reverse the waterfall, but rather to ask what price we have paid for this abundance of opinions. In this new media world, what's authentic, or perhaps better, what's the cost of having lost authenticity? It's worth putting Baudrillard's four points into the context of hockey writing to begin to understand. One, the first stage is a faithful image or copy where we believe, and it may even be correct, that a sign is a reflection of a basic reality. This could be the summary article written by a professional newspaper writer. His or her job is to represent what happened in the game based on direct observation, so that the reader can, over breakfast, get a real sense of what his or her team did the night before, reflecting. The second stage is distortion of reality, where we have come to believe the sign to be an unfaithful copy, though the sign can hint at the existence of an obscure reality which it is incapable of encapsulating. This is what might come in a sponsored blog, where the writer does answer to an editor and still attempts to write in a balanced way, but where the dialogue this prompts might reflect fan interest and bias. Call this obscuring. The third stage masks an absence of a basic reality, where the simulacrum pretends to be a faithful copy, but it is a copy with no original. This would come when the blogger is not writing for someone else, like SB Nation or another sanctioned website, but starts his or her own site. Publication is thus done for and by him or herself. The article might express opinions that are a further step removed from reality, if reality is assumed to be the event itself or a written report of that event, that's stage one above. Or it might be unmoored from historical representation, likely because the writer simply does not have this as his or her frame of reference. Call this unmooring. The fourth stage is pure simulation. This is a regime of total equivocation where cultural products need no longer even pretend to be real in a naive sense. This is Twitter, not all Twitter. Some professional writers use this medium to inform readers of the publication of an article or to disseminate facts or nuanced and supported opinions about a game. But Twitter's content, when it's fan speak, is what Baudrillard, looks like I have a typo, sorry, describes as signs reflecting other signs in what can easily devolve into an endless whirl of word noise. Let's call this equivocating. When I started to write about the NHL in 2005, the very idea of how the game was constructed by those reporting it was different from now, because to write about the league meant to be credentialed by a team. This gave one access to information, inside information, for example, in the dressing room. The job of the writer was to take the facts that he or she gleaned and add content and context and analysis to create meaning. Slowly. Now, interviews are captured on video and uploaded to team websites almost immediately, so that fans largely have the same information as media members do. Kevin Hull explained that, quote, the ability of Twitter to deliver news instantly in just one tweet allows fans not to have to wait until the evening news to get the latest information. Immediately after a game concludes, a team can act as its own media source and tweet from its official account all the pertinent information in less than 140 characters. Who is the authority there? A self-interested entity, the team. And how can all the pertinent information, whatever that is, be contained in a tweet? Now perhaps you see the problem. A surplus of data and the ease with which it is disseminated make constructing a story a conflicted thing, because the new media environment works against the careful consideration of events. Thus, to salvage any sort of successful reflecting must demand that the writer resist the downward pressure that new media exerts by its constant demand for unfiltered moreness, and have a theme, a point, and a focus which creates perspective. Yet while the writer can offer a combination of observational skills along with the ability to analyze, the torrent of media available has taught fans to experience their sport in the staccato present tense. In the past, not only the writer, but also the fan had to piece information together, what the newspaper said, what the radio said, what history said, to form not a coherent whole, but at least a picture. The process was gradual. I'd argue that the audience understood that they had to work to gain an understanding of events, even as they privileged some sources, like the sports page. Pointing out this active role is partly how I would speak back to someone who might accuse me of wanting to reinvent the master narrative, by arguing that the process was always a collaboration between reader and writer. The problem now is that there's no differentiation of roles in a media environment where information is unfiltered and voluminous. Now, there are so many highlights and so much chit-chat that pieces of the picture fly by so fast as not to be graspable, by which I don't mean comprehensible, but that one cannot attach oneself to them or stop them, turn them around in front of the eyes and analyze. The speed and plenty of such coverage makes it too easy to trade thinking for stimulation and end up with nothing but equivocation. And that's fine if that's what people want their discourse on sports to be. But if you believe Bakhtin when he says we experience the world only in terms of discourse, then this new discourse of about sports becomes the sport itself. Soon, all you're watching for are the highlights, and hockey becomes a series of great saves or sick dekes for goals. Isn't there something else? Now I'm almost done. TheAthletic.com has drawn the best sports world writers in the world away from newspapers and funneled them to the internet. Teams understand the value of this endeavor, and they cater to reporters from this outlet, giving them more access than others to players via one-on-one interviews and tolerating insider relationships, which allow these writers to have personal communications with coaches and team personnel. The model works by pushing sports coverage backwards in this equation, not a bad thing, from equivocating through unmooring, past obscuring, and on to reflecting. But two questions remain. One, is the revenue model sustainable since access to the site is by subscription? Two, can fans be retrained to read 1500 word and up articles that slowly parse out the truth in long form narrative? Even if we say yes to each, we still have to answer for validating a hegemony. I said retrained. Surely that must be offensive. That controls the narrative. For some, that might be a tough ask, but I'd rather take my NHL from Elliot at Sportsnet than from at Elliot Sucks on Twitter. Thank you. Okay, so questions from the audience. And I don't think I need to do anything more than just say that and have you all speak up, right?
Might help if people who wanted to ask a question put up their virtual hand.
Let me do the stop.
And then you can call on them in order.
How do I see that? Did the hands go in the, do I have to keep scrolling back and forth to see?
No, the hands pop up in the box. Watch, I'll put mine up. It's under reactions. Raise hand. See, my hand is up. Colin has his hand up, so I'll put mine down.
So Colin, go ahead.
Well, thanks to all three of you. What an interesting session, and from three good friends. And for me, it's both another expression of the triumph of the hockey conference over the years, but it has a sadder element too. And Jason will know this personally. In 2001, Jason's dad, Larry Holt, was one of the original contributors to the hockey conference. And he and I became very close friends over the years. And I remember, and this will have some context with the session as well, as he and I used to play music together and described ourselves as professors to T parentheses W-O-O. At one point, I remember in my music room downstairs in my basement, Larry and I doing a rendition of the hockey game. So things come full circle. We miss Larry so much, but watching Jason was like watching Larry all over again. So I loved it. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Colin, for those kind words and memories of my father. I still listen to that CD you two cut. In fact, I listened to it yesterday. So thank you.
Thanks, Jason.
Okay, so now we have to hear about the skate in the crease.
Right. So Jason, look at that, the 1999 conclusion to the Stanley Cup. That was Brett Hull's skate, right?
Yeah.
Oof, I'm trying to remember. It's been a while.
It was in the era where it had the strict rule about no skate in the crease, and it was clearly against the rule as constituted at that time. Mm-hmm. But they what happened was the goal was scored, the idiots at the arena opened the back door and everybody flooded onto the ice, so the referees just gave up trying to adjudicate the moment. So where does that fit in with the game theory and stuff?
Yeah, this kind of question goes at the very heart of what sport philosophers have been wrestling with for about 50 years. So I can't give a definitive answer, but I can give you some of the different positions. So most philosophers of sport are interpretivists, and they think that what constitutes game integrity will be a matter not of strict rules, not a matter of just conventions, which can vary socially and contextually and so on, but the gratuitous logic of the game, which is kind of in between, and a matter of the rules as interpreted and applied by appropriate officials. Now, in that sort of case, it seems like the officials did the best they could do under the circumstances. They actually couldn't make the best call because of the circumstances. They just couldn't. Now, maybe I'm getting those details wrong, but we want to distinguish, let's say, the final ruling of officials from the call that should have been made. So if the officials are the appropriate authorities to decide, then by whatever means they decide, that is the official result, even if it shouldn't have gone otherwise. So suits would probably say, you know, that whole series gets an asterisk and who knows, and that seems kind of ridiculous because then all results, all records would have an asterisk because we wouldn't really know. And the interpretivist would say, no, look, that's the way it turned out. Those in charge with rendering the decisions, those empowered, rendered their decision and they did the best they could under the circumstances, and that official result is appropriate. Is it regrettable? Sure. But just like judges can make maybe not the best decisions, but those decisions might stand and not be overturned because they can't, so too with officiating in sport. Anyway, long-winded answer, but that's pretty much how sport philosophers see it.
Anybody who wants to go to another session, we're at 9 o'clock, but we've been carrying these on. So if you want to stick around, I'm sure the others would agree we can carry on for a bit.
And I think there's a half hour break until the next session.
Time. So perfect. So, okay, when you were talking, I was thinking, is this not possibly true? The Dallas Stars did not win the Stanley Cup that year. They won an alternate version of the Stanley Cup. And I had it in terms of the theories that you were using, but I can't see them now. The writing's kind of a mess.
Yeah, the metagame maybe.
They won the metagame. But in fact, the 1999 Stanley Cup has not yet been decided. And somewhere out there, it needs to be adjudicated, just like the 1919 Stanley Cup with the influenza. So there are two Stanley Cup finals.
Now this is an implication. This is an implication of Suits's position, of his formalism. If games really are defined by the rules and rule violations are not caught, not redressed, then ultimately those games are moot. They're not decided, they're indeterminate. Does this mean they need to be played again? Well, we can accept the hard distinction between, say, being declared the winner of a contest and being the actual or legitimate winner of a contest. But that's exactly where the consensus in philosophy of sport has gone the other way. And they say, you know, we would have to be hyper skeptics about all sport results if we went that way, and we really can't. I kind of like the formalist position. I think there's something neat and right about it, even if they kind of miss the logic of the game aspect. So yeah, I like it. They didn't win, on Suits's view, they did not win the Stanley Cup. They won the Meta Stanley.
Right. Who were they? Oh, it was Buffalo. So that means Buffalo. Was that a game 7 though, or was that a game 6? I'm wondering if we could say Buffalo's won the actual Stanley Cup, or if they're still the perpetual outsiders they've been.
Great question, but I think you've got a question addressed to you in the comments, in the chat.
Yeah, can say so.
Do you believe traditional media and sports rights should be? I feel like, that's why I talked about hegemony and everything near the end. I think it's like the cow's out of the barn, right? So there's not much, other than being a careful reporter of the games, and I try to do that in my writing, And there are people doing it. I don't know how you change the attitude of the consumer of media, though. People just love, and you saw it this week with the Shifley hit and the suspension. And I mean, look, if none of that kind of nonsense discussion existed, then sports radio wouldn't have the market that it does, right? And I've been on all the NHL network shows in the morning, you know, on radio, talking about various things over the years. And I mean, there has to be a product to consume. Nobody wants to sit and listen to papers like I gave at 8 o'clock in the morning as their sports coverage, right? So I'm not sure it's possible to reverse the flow. I do think that as a cultural critic and everybody in this room, as somebody with a certain degree of cultural power, as a professor, teacher, mentor to people, you can teach people, your students, what they need to read and how they need to read. I do think, you know, this kind of dovetails into this whole online education thing. If your students, I'm an English professor, if my students are doing their entire course on their phone, I just don't think they can possibly be engaged at the level of literacy that I feel is important. But I could just be talking about an era that's past. From Corey to everyone, what does it mean that the rules were changed, therefore in retrospect, the Brett Hull goal was actually legal, right? So then, Jason, does it matter that the rules, so we think of hockey or any sport as a fixed thing. I think maybe football is a better example of how sports have changed, but hockey's not what hockey was in 1999. There's all kinds of
differences. Yeah, and most of these rule changes apply from the change forward rather than retroactively. So, I mean, I can't think of an example of a rule that is meant to apply retroactively.
I don't know. Offside changes.
When they changed the foot in the crease rule after the Brett Hull goal, there was an implication that they'd made a mistake,
right?
In trying to be so categorical about it, and so there was almost like a mea culpa from the league, when they changed that rule. Yeah. So
yeah. Sport philosophers might say something like this: the reason rules are updated is because game design is an ongoing process. So you devise a game, it's great, but as you go along, you get better and better rules, just like in the legal system, you get better and better laws because the needs of the players, the needs of society change because we're improving the game or improving the laws, given how it evolves. In either case.
Oh, sorry. Jason Blake, are you still there with your hand up? Go ahead, Jason Blake. You have to unmute yourself.
Yeah, thanks. Can you hear me okay?
I hope. Yep, perfect.
You may regret that. yeah, because thanks.
Thanks. How are the cocktails?
The cocktails, yeah. That was supposed to be private. I'm still getting used to Zoom. I have a cereal. Somewhat more serious. I was wondering about the role of authenticity in all this, because I mean that's the beauty of a game. I mean, you lose 1-0, and that's it. I mean, life is not confusing. That's provided there's no skate in the crease or whatever. Provided the goal went over the line and such. How does that fit into for suits, that seems pretty clear cut, but how does that fit into the Baudrillard scheme? Mm-hmm. I'll give you an anecdotal counterexample. I once checked the Herald Tribune, remember newspapers, a long time ago, and they gave the wrong result for a Montreal playoff game. I mean, not in moral terms, I mean, in actual terms. They said Montreal won, but that was actually the opposite. And I can be postmodern, but they lost. Well,
that's the thing with the Baudrillard, is that it can be rendered absurd if you take it to its logical extreme, right? So there's never going to be authenticity. You can't put the toothpaste back in the tube. You might as well not bother trying. You know, just looping back to connecting your question to Thaisa's question, it's an interesting suggestion that her question makes, which is that the traditional reporter has no choice, or it's inevitable that she or he do all this other stuff. And I remember when they started making the LA Times reporters tweet about the game, they were, you know, Helene Elliott, who's a Hockey Hall of Fame member and a writer here in LA, has been for decades. She was so outraged at this nonsense that, you know, that's what they would be doing. But now everybody's doing it and there's not really much of a choice. I just think there's a difference between tweeting about the game from a point of view of somebody who has analyzed and processed than, you know, let me grab my phone and tell everybody how stupid they are, which is kind of what Twitter, unfortunately, has become. I mean, it's just, it's honestly every few days, the nastiness of Twitter comes up as a topic on the Sportsnet radio show at, I don't know what.
There's such an avalanche of responses to things online now too. I know one of my sons is a musician and he said, it's crazy that if a well-known artist releases a new song, there's immediately hundreds of video reviews of it. All these people competing for clicks, right? And they develop their own channels and they review, you know, everything. And of course they can use the famous names to draw people onto their blog, right? So it's a review of Bruno Mars. Then when you do Bruno Mars, you might get this blog, right? And I think the same thing with sports and news and all these things. There's this just massive proliferation of kind of tertiary elements. And I think it's really challenging our role as scholars, and you know, we sort of presume to be deeper thinkers and want to have more sustained attention on things. And it's a skill that I do think it's kind of threatened by this vast snowstorm of responses that people now encounter for everything. I don't know.
Everybody wants the attention for themselves, like you say, though. They're using the Bruno Mars thing to get their YouTube channel more clicks. Yeah.
But they would do the same thing, and the sports ones would do the same thing too, right? Yeah.
Andrew, Andy Holman says, we call it crowd writing. It should be lauded for its participatory nature. Who should control the narrative? And I guess that in my paper is what I kind of admit near the end, yeah, that the narrative is beyond control. Mm-hmm. I don't know what to do about that. And, you know, fortunately, there are still some outlets that let you write careful, considered, lengthy pieces. And I think there's still an audience for it, but it's not the audience anymore. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's just what we have to accept.
Yeah. Well, I think there are values to it too, as well. There are positives to it, but it's definitely a challenge.
I mean, the problem is when the same opinion gets rendered 1,000 times, it really isn't much of an opinion anymore. Yeah. The other end of it is, I remember one night being in the Kings locker room and they were, you know, we were doing our little interview scrums and whatever. And usually if guys are sitting there, you can approach them and you try to get unique stuff. And I remember, I don't know how long ago this was, but it must've been relatively early in the new media era, like maybe 2012 or 13. One of them was somebody, Mark Spector, who I'm sure everybody knows, two writers leaving the room saying, why is the team sending all this stuff out right now? We don't have anything left for us. The Professional Hockey Writers Association should complain. And I thought, yeah, that makes sense, but there is no way you're going to convince the team, because they are creating a brand as well. You're not going to convince them not to release these interviews right away. The only hope you can have is that if everybody has the same information, they still want your analysis, because that's what you bring to it. Like I said in there somewhere, context and history are important. So I guess I'm saying my writing's better than those tweets in a way. Well, I think there is a point to the craft.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Do you know, Brian, if the league and teams have designated communications people who respond sort of even anonymously to chains and websites continuing to sort of promote their point of view?
Well, they have people who are responsible for new media, social media and stuff.
Looks like Stacy has a question.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Stacy.
I think Colin had his hand up before I did, if it's still supposed to be up.
Oh, I was assuming it wasn't. Sorry.
Yeah. Are you still there, Colin?
I'm just not sure if...
Go ahead.
I think you just left it up.
The question came at the first.
Yeah. Go ahead, Stacy.
All right. Can you hear me? I seem to have something going on here.
Yep.
Okay. There's so many, I'm just fascinated by all of these media questions that, I mean, obviously, especially that Brian raised, but I think they also go back to some of Jamie's, you know, your examination of kind of that, the hockey song as kind of the defining or authoritative traditional version of the sport. And what I'm wondering about in terms of media is, and I mean, I'm mostly in the Edmonton media market where we actually have reporters who covered, you know, the Oilers in the 80s who are still the mainstream media voices, but who are really ridiculed almost because their views are so out of date and just kind of, they're either straightforward, here's what happened, or they're seen as just mouthpieces for the team sort of thing. And there's kind of a sort of the Oilogosphere, which I think the Oilers blogging community was one of the most influential and highly developed early, you know, forms of that. I mean, there's been a number of voices there who have really asserted themselves as kind of a thoughtful, considered, combining their observations with analytics and so forth, who have really become a go-to voice for a lot of fans in the market. And so there's all the other sort of noise that you talked about. So I certainly see and I mean, this isn't, everybody would know this, but this fragmentation and this, you know, so on the one hand, you don't have that authoritative, here's what I read in the Edmonton Journal or the Edmonton Sun. You have all of these different perspectives, but in many ways we can kind of curate our own, exposure to all of those voices in ways that are, I think way better than what we could have done before when we only read one or two people all the time. So how do you kind of factor that in? And then you add the fact that there's more and more people that are, you know, not even watching the games as much anymore. They're just following the chatter about it. So there's so many different layers to this, but mainly, I guess I'm wondering where you see, Brian, that kind of, thoughtful, analytical, not objective, but, you know, removed from the team. They don't go and get the interviews and so forth, but they watch the games, they write about them, they use the analytics and so forth. Where would those voices fall into your
mind? Yeah, that's something maybe maybe on the second part of that. Where's the, did I write all this down? So they're not reflecting by Baudrillardian standards because they don't have direct access, but maybe obscuring, but we have to maybe redefine that as not negative. The other thing to say is, so there is a category of people, you're right. You may see it more in your market than we do here in Los Angeles. There's just not a ton of really smart sports reporting about hockey, partly because no one cares, and partly because they send people to cover games who don't really understand the game and have no context. and I'm not telling stories or naming names, but I've been in at games in the press box, looked over at someone writing a story about the game, and he's trolling for hockey cards or buying sandals, or, and all they really end up doing is just writing a transcription of when the goals were scored, which to me isn't what you're there to do. You're not value adding anything. Is the guy you're talking about the one, Stacy, the one that we've discussed before? I can't bring his name to mind.
Well, probably the most influential one. And that's kind of where, and this is where it really gets interesting, because the guy I'm thinking of, maybe I'll turn my video on here too.
What's
the guy I'm thinking of here is Alan Mitchell, known as the blogger Low Tide.
Yeah, Low Tide, right.
But he has a really interesting, it's a really interesting dynamic, because he actually is a person who has worked in media for a long time, but not as a sports person. He was either, you know, a sort of a DJ, or he was actually, I think, on the advertising side for a while. But then he started his blog, which is one of the most influential hockey blogs out there. But then because he was so successful in articulating that view, he actually now has his own radio show on the sports radio station for 2 hours a day in the morning. And he's one of the writers for The Athletic.
Yeah, see, that means what he's done is he's moved his way over to the first thing on the Baudrillard scale.
Yeah, so it's a really fascinating, like, there's just so many different layers to this. And even with The Athletic, I would say, like, it looks like they're in, like, I love reading some of the things in The Athletic, whether it's for hockey coverage or basketball coverage, like the Raptors. They have some great writers and podcasts that come out of The Athletic, but I don't know if people are willing to pay for that. And the, like, now they're, you know, $1 a month sign up, and I don't know how they can keep that model going. There's just no way. They run stories, as you said, that are demanding of the reader. Like, you don't read a little 500 word summary. Like, they've got long, long in-depth stories there. So it's just such an interesting time for all of these different levels of engagement and moving back and forth across these different platforms and so forth. So it's just a really, yeah, you've given me a lot to think about here in terms of some of that as well. So that was
Jamie,
really,
let's end with another question about Stompin' Tom. They play that song frequently in the period breaks at the Kings games. Now, I can't remember exactly when, and it's been a year, but is there an interesting thing to be said about the fact that they play it here? What are they doing? Because that's a very unsophisticated, non-Los Angeles sounding thing, right? Are they appealing to the Canadians in the audience, or what do you think they're doing, maybe?
Yeah, maybe. I don't know. I'd have to sort of understand hockey fans in LA a little.
I mean, well, they don't probably have any idea who Bobby is. They know about the cup because they've now won two of them. But I always laugh. It seems to me that it's in the second intermission, and it's when the Zamboni comes out and starts going around. So there's this sort of lull where they can't be doing like a quiz game on the ice or one of these other gimmicks they have to keep fans interested between periods, right? So here comes Stompin' Tom song, and I look around every time and I think, what is the appeal here, you know?
Yeah, well, the league is, and the teams constantly manage the what it is that people are going to focus on as the sort of pleasurable experience of watching the game. And so it's a really useful song for, you know, reinforcing this nostalgic, innocent version of the game, just like the good, you know, Take Me Out to the Ball Game, which is probably played everywhere. So I could see it as them thinking this is part of them creating the experience that people enjoy.
They don't do it in Anaheim, by the way. That's a whole different audience down there too. Yeah. Very much like those people are just singular fans of the Ducks, not really fans of hockey. Most of them are very unsophisticated in their interpretations of the game. Wow. And there's none of this sort of, you know, signaling back to the mother country or whatever, if you want to call it that.
Baudrillard, though, you know, we have the original, then you have the simulacrum going on in Los Angeles. By the time it gets to Slovenia, it's no longer authentic whatsoever, unless I'm singing it.
Where's there a Slovenian translation?
Who said that? Say that again.
It'd be interesting to hear it in a Slovenian translation.
Right. No, they do. No, it's just in English.
Got a guitar over there?
Yeah.
Ukulele.
Yes.
Sing us a version. That would be great. The Tiny Tim Slovenian version of.
Great to talk to you guys. I better go because I want to get some breakfast.